Leigh wanted to make the legend of Leigh Bowery the most unbelievable story that anyone had ever heard.
He's been a fashion designer. He ran possibly the most outrageous club ever, Taboo.
This is a man who is absolutely extraordinary. He's beautiful. He looks outrageous. He's a walking art form. May I introduce my next guest?
Here he is, Leigh Bowery. Yeah.
I think Leigh was an entertainer.
He was everything bad in a really good mixture, because he was like a bit of a thief, a bit of a liar, really mischievous. I always refer to him as a genius.
And here we find ourselves at afternoon tea time. Where else? The beautiful Georgian restaurant, where I've been coming for many, many moons since I was a small boy. The staff here adore me.
He enjoyed confusing people. He enjoyed the kind of creating a response of, like, you know, what the fuck is that?
Leigh was the greatest of the great outrageous Australians of modern times.
You got it! Woo! You got it! Woo! You got it! You got it all wrong! Woo!
Well, see, Bowery doesn't fit into a box, and that was one of the reasons why we were very interested in having him in the collection of the National Gallery of Victoria, because we wouldn't actually classify him purely as a fashion designer.
If somebody asked you what did Leigh do, it was very hard to say what he did. I mean, you could say that he did a club and he did performance and stuff like that, but it wasn't a label that satisfied a questioner.
I just thought that he was really the sickest person that a spotlight ever hit.
I think of all the people I can think of, he's the person who came nearest to actually living his life as a work of art.
There's a kind of beautiful sort of irony that a character like Leigh Bowery, who is probably one of the few individuals in 20th century culture who could genuinely be described as art through anti-art, should have ended up being the model for one of the 20th century's greatest painters.
Rather than, say, do a painting on canvas or sculpting with clay, I put all these ideas onto myself.
I always used to think that New Yorkers must wonder what London's like. If people are walking around dressed like that. But Leigh was actually the only one.
In 20 years' time, there'll be these kind of Leigh Bowery gangs. There will be this kind of cult of Leigh Bowery kind of gangs, in the same way, like Clockwork Orange.
What a good idea!
Now, are there a lot of people like you in Sunshine Australia, or are you?
Oh, I'm not completely sure. I think I might be. I think I'm one in a million.
He wanted his name to be left in history. He wanted, yeah, I guess, what's the word for it? Immortality?
He was the first of a grandchild in the family, and therefore he's doted on quite a lot, really. His mother curled his hair, and quite often it was said by people seeing him being walked down the street in the pram, "Well, I was a lovely girl, you know."
Leigh's relationship with my mother was one that was strong. They had a special connection, and he really liked to be around her. He loved to kind of cook. She was a great cook. And she taught him how to knit and to sew, and he would always love sitting around with the women, butting in and having conversations with them.
Well, Sunshine was a working class community, an industrial community, and my wife's family had lived there all their life.
The street that I lived in, my mother was literally born in. She lived across the road. When she was first born, her mother had her in the front bedroom, and when she was older, she got married and built a house across the road.
Yes, from a small town just outside Melbourne called Sunshine. The way he talked about it, I thought it was like three houses and, I don't know, a church.
We took them to Sunday school and to give them a Christian upbringing.
So it was a very conservative environment. There was no swearing in the house. There was no, you weren't allowed to gamble or even buy, you know, like a raffle ticket or anything of that nature.
His dad's like a man's man, you know, a real proper man's man. And he saw this son of his who was like a great strapping lad who'd be ideal to play Australian rules football or whatever, rather than sitting in the corner doing his mum's hair and doing a bit of crochet work.
I remember when Leigh was probably about 7 or 8, he one day announced at the table when we were having dinner that he was going to be a comedian.
Why do I want to provoke? I think I might have to get back to my parents on this point. My parents, unfortunately, belong to the Salvation Army in Australia. And they're very, very sort of ordinary and very sort of orthodox sort of people. My mother's especially religious, and my father is, after meeting her.
Leigh stopped going when he was probably about 15 or 16 and just went, that's it, I'm out of here.
Yeah, when he was in Australia, he studied music, very, very talented musician.
He could have been a great musician. I mean, you've probably heard Leigh sit down and play Chopin and fantastic.
He just loved the piano. He'd walk past the piano and just sit down and thump away at it, whatever tune was in his head at the time.
And so, yeah, he just embraced music. He loved it. It was like his therapy. He would come and sit in his towel and play the piano at all times of night. Whenever you could tell when Leigh was sort of wanting to vent, he'd be on the piano venting his frustrations. When he was young, he was like an A student all the time, and right up until probably he was about 16, and then he became interested in life more than school.
I think he was very sexually active when he was at high school. He told me that wearing a school uniform was just the best thing that a boy could ask for if he wanted to pick up casual sex.
He used to pretend he was at choir practice after school, but all the time he was at Melbourne Central Station, getting off with a large variety of Australian gentlemen.
I think he was always worried maybe you'd bump into someone from the church. I think it was a bit obvious that he was gay when he was home. Although I did remember that earlier on in life he sort of tried to cage a few of my female friends that came over and enticed them into the bedroom.
His parents thought he would be a musician, and so they were a bit shocked when he went into sewing.
When Leigh went to uni and started studying fashion, he was enormously frustrated because the first thing that they said that he had to learn how to do was make babies' clothing and underwear. And he just said, if I'm ever going to be able to sort of experiment with fashion, then I can't do it here.
He came home and just said to us that I've decided that, I want to go to England.
And he read all these magazines, and just London seemed to be where it was at. And also it was easy for him because he had an English grandparent, so he could get a passport easily and come and stay here for as long as he liked.
London seemed really like the only place in the world, and I had to go there.
He was over 18 and legally an adult, and we said, well, Leigh, we can't stop you legally, but I would like to sort of put a proviso there that you have a return ticket to come back to Australia, and you also have $1,000 in the bank as well. So that when you arrive there, you do have something to fall back on.
Yeah, when he first arrived in the country, his sort of money he'd saved up was running out, so he got a job in Burger King. Until he realised he had to leave when they told him they wanted to promote him to manager. You just realised, well, this is it, sorry. I didn't come to London to work in Burger King.
I suppose really what stimulated me more than anything has always been ideas. Ideas really get me excited, all sorts of ideas. And so the area that sort of gives you most freedom with ideas is art, because there's no barriers, there's no parameters, it's completely free. So that's the area in which I've placed myself now. Fashion was the thing that I was always really excited about.
Because in the early 80s, fashion was a place of ideas, and I think lots of people were into fashion that would have at another time been into music or been into art.
In the early 80s, the fashion scene was completely mixed in with all the other media. Young filmmakers, young dancers, DJs, everyone was, there was a bubble, a creative bubble. And everyone was very circular in their actions. Everyone talked to each other, played off each other. It was a complete work hard, play hard psychology. So Leigh was part of the fashion. And of course, you know, he was the ultimate icon of that era, really, because he completely mixed himself in with all the different types of creative processes.
The first time I ever saw Leigh was at the Camden Palace. Leigh and Trojan turned up in their kind of Package from Outer Space look. And I can remember sort of dismissing them a bit the first time I saw them, because in the past I'd kind of gone out with blue and yellow faces and different colours all over me. So I was like, oh, I've seen it before. But then on closer inspection, I actually realised it was actually quite remarkable.
In fact, it was quite different from anything anybody else was doing. And this kind of involved body paint, kind of like full face, brightly coloured body paint with kind of plastic, PVC, shiny, fluorescent coloured caps, lots of glitter makeup as well, huge platform shoes.
It was great, it was very extreme. He said, if you're going to do something short, do it short. If you're going to do something long, do it extra long. You know, it's like, it was never in between. You know, if we were doing a skirt, I said, shall I cut the slit to the thigh or to above the knee? He said, why don't you slit it right up below the armpit? I mean, it's kind of, you never even think of bringing it that far.
I think the only modern thing left to exaggerate is the belly. This idea is a prototype which I'll be developing. Eventually, I'll have a diving board coming from my bust.
We were invited to Japan by the Hanamori Fashion Foundation, and I think it was 16 designers, and Leigh was sort of the crazy, wacky London designer. Leigh was doing the sort of hideous, sort of baby pink, baby doll nighty look with frilly knickers with the arse hanging out. And the Japanese audience were absolutely, didn't know what to make of it at all. They were completely shocked silent.
He sort of created fashion, but he took it somewhere else, really. It seemed to work as art, as fashion, as, you know, anything, because it was so authentic and funny and witty and sort of weird.
The fibres of this jacket are synthetic and very hard wearing, and these hair grips have helped me through many a crisis.
The funny thing about Leigh is, you know, I used to say to him, you know, why don't you make clothes? And he was like, oh no. The idea of, he didn't just want any old person wearing his clothes, which I thought was quite quite funny, I thought, you know, because he could probably make quite a bit of money out of that.
He did make one or two coats and tops that he sold that were reasonably commercial, but you ended up looking a little bit like Leigh.
Do you think of the clothes that you're wearing, which are they fairly typical?
Yeah, they are of my collection.
Now, do you think people are actually going to be wearing them?
Leigh didn't really want anyone else to wear his clothes. which is not very good for a fashion designer. He was his own best creation, really.
I did like the idea of dressing up and the way clothes can change people and all of those things and the excitement of putting on different things and going out. And there was Punk and Neuromantic, which I liked even more than Punk.
No doubt.
And at that time, it was the fashion to spend hours getting dressed up and then go out, and it was like peacock theory.
Rachel, you don't look good in black. Trojan, you don't look good in that dress. I've got an idea I'm going to change myself. Listen, it's early enough. Michael hasn't arrived yet. We've still got time to change and look H.O.T. for the nightclub.
Have you tried plastic surgery?
How bitter can one woman be?
Oh, you should know.
Neuromanticism was about getting ready. It wasn't about going out. It was about getting ready. And I think that getting ready became an art form. Anybody in their bedsit, whether they were out in the suburbs or some sort of dingy high-rise somewhere, could become this legendary artist making themselves, and then maybe not even bothering to go out because they couldn't get a cab or because it was too far or...
Punk's dead, Michael.
Did I hear you mention my name?
Oh, you look like
Punk. Yeah, it's my middle name, Michael. You should know by now. I'm the punk of the 80s.
Oh, you've lost so much weight, Leigh.
No, it's just this garment. It's behind.
You might have a garment that fits me. I feel a bit underdressed.
I think you do a bit as well. Look okay.
You always do.
Well, why don't you try and slip something on from my wardrobe? Oh. There's plenty of things out there.
That does look nicely, I must say.
Oh, thank you. It's very unusual to get a compliment from you, Rachel.
Oh, Leigh, that's lovely.
Still not quite sure.
What about?
Well, I don't know. Is it today?
Having grown up in that whole New Romantic period, I mean, I came from sort of punk through the New Romantic thing, and it was hard to do something different. There'd been so many characters around over the years that I'd known myself, that I'd been out clubbing with, that had done pretty much everything, or you imagine they'd done pretty much everything you could do with a look. So I guess Leigh had a real job on his hands when he came to London.
Oh, heavens above, there's not one single thing left. Looks pretty good.
Whenever I've asked him for a design, he designs exactly what he's been wearing that week. So, I mean, I knew, asking him, that that's what I was going to get.
Hey, Tip, would you be keen on sort of trying to simulate that look on some dancers I'm working with? And I said, well, I'll try. He said, oh, great. He said, we're performing in 3 days' time.
Whatever Michael was around at that time, like, whoever he was around and what was happening in his life at that time, he'd interpret it through his choreography, through his work.
Quite soon after I'd met Leigh, there was a kind of period of experimenting with our behaviour, really, in all sorts of ways.
And we were wild. We did have a... In retrospect...
Experimental as well. We were experimenting with our with life and what we could do, what we could get away with.
I suppose the first time I really... knew we'd work well together was at a place called the Pink Panther, and they had like this cutout of Kajagoogoo on the wall, and he ripped it down and shat on it. I knew from that moment on that it was, you know, going to be the ideal collaboration.
Your decadent sins will reap discipline.
You Puritan, you shun me. I wash every day.
The first piece that my company did had body suits which were shorts as well, zip up the front, and the bottoms were cut out. Also, we both had platform shoes. They were quite hard to get at the time. I remember that my platform boots were two left feet because we couldn't actually find a pair at that point. I mean, I quite liked early on that he would bring something impossible, you know, or very difficult to work with. But I think I've always been fortunate in having dancers who are kind of open to that.
And then we'd have to go and dance in his Leigh Bowery costume, which is impossible. Impossible.
But genius.
But fantastic, you know. Theatre.
Certainly at that time, a lot of dance was dressed in a very dowdy way, very boring way, sort of street clothes, which his things were completely the opposite to. On the one hand, some being very simple, very strict, juxtaposed to some very extravagant statements, but always in a world totally individual and totally almost a fantasy.
I know myself, for example, in New Puritan, the costume allowed me to create a whole new character, really, which wouldn't have been possible without that costume.
But always good, it's like I've drunk myself sober, the better as I get older.
I hoped that each element would be equally strong, but I wanted them to be codependent.
Just had enough imagination to say, I'm going to give it this, and actually be strong enough and push Michael in that direction and say, this is it.
He was going through this spot look, which I never really got. But he was very persistent that, you know, people were going to like it or lump it, really.
I mean, there were not times when we would do a premiere performance, where we hadn't even seen the costumes. We were about to go on stage for a major performance. There was one in Amsterdam.
These are Leigh's costumes.
These are Leigh's costumes. The costumes were arrived, and these costumes were with wigs,
hats this big,
face furniture. What a, and we were about
doors,
to go on. The
doors
jacket
on...
has just arrived. And...
And then later, towards the end of Because We Must, he'd done like a series of... the men had shoulder pads, which kind of came to the top of their heads, like a very square shoulder pads. And the women had dresses which were kind of half a sphere that could be flipped up. So you had the kind of framed person wearing the dress, or you could pull it down, so it became like this very big shape. By Modern Masterpiece, for example, Leigh was making costumes which are very much about the choreography. But also there was a very easy exchange of ideas because we were spending a lot of time together anyway. It wasn't like we had meetings to discuss projects. It was just a kind of very easy dialogue. I was generally encouraging him to perform, I suppose, but it was kind of like coaxing him into the work. It took a couple of years before he was actually very present in the work.
I think in the beginning he was quite nervous about it, to be going on to a stage with professionally trained dancers and being able to sort of hold his own.
I was trying to work with stuff that he would find natural, like looking at his watch or tapping his foot, or quite simple stuff.
Michael really sort of brought him into the whole thing of putting on a show and not only doing the costumes but being part of it. And
like, his nature was to, you know, be quite kind of full on.
He was such a sort of live wire, Michael asked him to be in his shows. So that gave him a taste for the stage and
brought out a whole performance side of his work, which had maybe before only existed on the dance floors of nightclubs or entrances into parties or exits, etc.
There was quite a negativity towards Leigh's presence in Michael's work. The dance critics were always wanting Leigh not to be in Michael's work. They sort of felt that it was this immature, they just want to shock us kind of feeling.
What he brought to the whole show was magical. I always felt that in the end, I think he really was living for that.
I think that the theatre's maybe like a slightly limiting place to do things.
So you've branched out from the nightclub?
Well, the nightclub's all of those things as well. It's performance, it's music, it's fashion, it's, you know, art. All of those things that I've always liked, the clubs have always been.
There's something really dull about London, and it encourages people to make it more exciting. I think you wake up in the morning, you see the most dull sky and the most dull, dreary people everywhere, and everyone's miserable, and you think, come on, let's have a party, let's get dressed up, let's do something.
It was a complete sort of getting away from, you know, the boring drudgery of life as it was then. It was just much more exciting to dress up and be this other person for the night.
People look at the 80s as being quite a vacuous decade, and, you know, we had sort of right-wing politics, but at the same time, lots of really quite adventurous things happened during the 80s.
There was an underground. I mean, if you lived in London, you really had to know what was what. There was like the third Tuesday of the month, or the second Thursday, or alternate months on a Monday, and lots of little travelling clubs like that. And Leigh was right in the middle of it.
Well, he'd always thought he'd want to open a nightclub, but, you know, he was a bit nervous to do it on his own and everything. And then luckily,
Tony Gordon had approached him, asked him to join him in doing a nightclub.
So Leigh was thrilled at this, and I remember he went to the club and he came back, it's fantastic, it's really tatty. You know, it's got mirror balls and tatty lights, oh, it's fantastic, it's going to be great.
I think Taboo was the peak of what clubs should be about, and it was the pinnacle of deranged, decadent expression.
Taboo was really about excess.
Yeah, it wasn't like standing around posing and saying, look at me, I'm gorgeous. It was, look at me, I'm having a great time.
You had this tiny little club in Leicester Square, and it was like an event, you know, to go to that club.
The week seemed to revolve around Thursdays. You know, Friday was your recovery day, and then the weekend would be the thinking about the outfit for the next week.
Oh, listen, come through anyway.
With Taboo, the more freaky and extreme and overt and outré you looked, the more you were guaranteed to get in for nothing and be given free drink.
Could I get into your club dressed like this?
Tell her the truth, Lou. Well, let's face it, you're verging on celebrity, aren't you, Josephine?
Verging. I like the verging, yes.
So I think if you sort of explained who you were, you would have no trouble at all.
I'd been dressing up quite a bit you know, throughout my teens and whatever. And I really wanted to sort of like be with other people who were really dressed up too. And I just found the looks that were there going on in Taboo were just so fantastic. And seeing Leigh was just basically the epiphany of all of this fantastic art.
Sort of when I arrived at the club at about 12, and the minute he arrived, it was like everything lifted up and the atmosphere started.
He was like a magnet. He was like a magnet to just kind of everyone. No one could believe the audacity, I guess, that he had to wear the outfits that he did.
Oh, no, no.
Nightclubs are a very important part of my life. I always go out there because all my friends do, and the social side of a fashion designer is very, very important.
Taboo was really pushing people's limits. It was like an endurance test. People took tons of drugs and got really, really drunk and then went there and took more. And it wasn't so much about dressing up, it was about falling apart, I thought, that club. If you didn't have scars and bruises after you'd been to Taboo, then you really hadn't had a good time. Arrived anyway, it was a great moment. You know, Leigh's here, and he took up a lot of space. You know, it was, and there were cameras around him, and there was excitement. It was great when Leigh arrived.
And if they hadn't noticed him enough, then he'd be out on the dance floor dancing and shaking it about, and bashing into people to make sure that even more people noticed.
He was too much, I swear. I found his presence sometimes quite frightening. I really, really ran away, in fact, sometimes when he was around, because I knew he was going to come up to me, try and pick me up by my ankles and swing me over his shoulder in some way. And this would normally take place in the middle of the club.
And by the time of, like, the early 90s, his persona in clubs was very much that of the sort of grand dame turning up. You know, the fact he was there meant it was a, you know, a trendy night. He wouldn't go anywhere naff.
If he had something special coming up and we were working on outfits, then he would tend to go out more because it was an opportunity to try out if the boots work, if this works, if it stays together.
Every time he went out, it was really like a performance for him, and he got the jitters. The general thing was basically lots of vodka and Diet Coke was his main drink, his main tipple. He didn't particularly like drinking. He didn't drink unless he was actually going to go out. He drank to get drunk and a bit pissed, and I think that's mainly because most of his garments were pretty painful to wear. And that was the only way that he could actually get through the night.
You know, it seemed to egg him on even more, really. You know, the more difficult the outfit was to wear, the more of a challenge he had, I think. I don't know where he got his energy or his resistance from. I mean, he could go suffocated in complete discomfort with sweat pouring down him. And he could go out and have a really good time and get really drunk and everything. And I don't know, in those situations, that's when you kind of realise that this wasn't a normal person.
I was more excited by the way he made every moment of the performance. And so the costumes were almost part of the performance.
When you look at those costumes on their own without Leigh, there's nothing there. And almost Leigh in the costume, it's actually what he did. You know, that actually going to a nightclub dressed up could be a work of art.
Like I was saying, a lot of people dress up, but, you know, that kind of energy and that kind of... I mean, you know, like, I remember telling him, when he's, you know, it's like, you know, just working solidly, you know, with sewing machines 24 hours a day just to go out on a night. It's like, you know, it's completely insane. You kind of want to put it in a museum or something. But then it's like takes away from it if you do that. I mean, I think it's art, definitely. Because it, I mean, did you know, it fills all the criteria of art, but it's not something you can sell in an art gallery.
What are, what are your tits made of, dear?
Well, willpower more than anything.
Beautiful. Willpower.
His tits were basically his stomach, strapped up around his neck with a load of gaffer tape.
With just a bit of makeup, this gaffer tape, and then a bra, which sort of, you know, built it out even more.
And so I was sporting this pussy wig that I devised, which was really good as well, because I didn't need strings or anything, and I could kick my legs all about the place, and nothing spilled out or fell out.
He used to gaffer tape up his pussy, so to speak, by getting gaffer tape and sort of like, you know, his willy was upwards, so he sort of like, it all taped into a nice sort of like V shape, like a pubic area for a woman. And so that was taped up, and that must have been pretty painful for him. I mean, he couldn't pee from that moment on. And then on top of that, he would put lots of mastix glue, and he would stick what we called a merkin.
You know, you just cut the crown out of any old wig, basically, and the more ginger and the more curly, I think the more Leigh liked it.
Even though that the sexuality of a lot of those looks was kind of flagrant, there was a sort of asexuality to that somehow. Leigh would only really ever have sex with people outside dressing up hours.
In many ways, I've had to forsake the sexual side of things because of the way I look.
He was not lucky in love. Had a lot of sex.
I think sometimes he had 3 or 4 men a day. You know, he'd go miles. If he heard there was a good cottage somewhere, he would travel miles, like, you know, he used to go to Southall, and it was killed 2 birds with 1 stone. So he got beautiful fabric to make things with, and also there was a very good cottage there. And you're walking down the road with him, like the road where he lived, like the most ordinary looking man you could imagine. A walk by, had him. Another one. Oh, I've had him.
He had a strange kind of liaison with an old Chinese man who lived near to Farrell House. So sometimes he'd just pop out, and then he'd always come back and said it was the rice bowl.
This is a card from Scotland. I had sex in a park with a man who said on completion, "You're Leigh Bowery, aren't you?" I said, "Guilty as charged." He said, "Are you always so slutty, so eager to please?" I said, "What are you getting at?" He said, "Nothing, you just seem so desperate, so hungry." I said, "You were my charitable act of the week." He said, "Ditto, you were mine." I said, "I don't think there's anything left to say." He said, "Except goodbye." As he walked away, I shouted, "I love you."
He walked around the house naked a lot. He loved being naked, and he'd get out of the bath or something, and I'd be sitting in the lounge room reading the paper, and he'd come into the lounge room and dance naked in front of me. And he'd say, 700 men can't be wrong, Anne. Come on, come on.
Yeah, he had this elephant trunk of a penis, go waving it in the public toilets at the urinals, you know, and then going to lock up with businessmen in suits and briefcases.
And there's nothing he adored more, except the mortifying time he was caught. He phoned me up and went, Sue, terrible things happened. So I was thinking, yeah, right. Then it went on and on, this terrible story about how he'd been caught cottaging at Liverpool Street Station. I still found it hard to believe, but it wasn't. Then the man, of course, because he was always married men he got off with at Liverpool Street Station, waiting for their trains home. So anyway, they got caught, and the man, to save his skin, said that he'd been sexually abused by Leigh. I mean, you know, how a grown man would end up in one cubicle with another man, just like that, and then got sexually abused is bizarre. But anyway, this is the story he took to court. And Leigh was working for Lucien at the time, and of course Lucien didn't want him to go to prison because it would ruin his picture. So he paid for Lord Goodman, who was the Queen's solicitor. So Leigh very proudly boasted. And I think he got off with quite a small fine.
Could you describe your stage performances?
They're more or less just a big entrance, and that's what it is. The longest one, I think, has been about 5 minutes. And I like it to be a big entrance with a surprise, and so it'll be as memorable as possible.
I watched him do one of his enemas on stage.
He used to do the splits and spin on his head wearing a crash helmet. I saw him doing that many a time, and how he did it without breaking his back, I don't know. Anyway, this time we decided he was going to add a nice fountain touch to it.
Well, I remember sort of standing in this sort of VIP box, and he come down on this pulley and then just sort of stood on his shoulders. And
what he'd done was he'd douched pints of water up his back passage
And halfway through his routine, he bent over with his sort of bum to the audience.
According to him, he farted when at the wrong moment, and that's when the famous emission scattered across the front audience. There's been a lot of exaggerated stories about that, saying he did it deliberately, saying he had diarrhea, and I'm glad I wasn't there.
Lots of people in the front row actually were hit by the whatever came out.
And people were really upset, you know, people were saying, that's disgusting, and it's really offensive, and I was just like, oh, you know, that's what he does.
I wish there was no difference between the stage and the street, but there is.
I was walking around one of the West End with Leigh one evening, and it was amazing how terrifying he was to sort of casuals, you know, the sort of kids that would normally kick you or start fights with you. Leigh was so big and threatening, and his costumes were so over the top that they kind of defied description. You see, with a sort of typical drag queen, you can sort of put them in a box marked inoffensive and fluffy. You know that they're a bit fey and they don't threaten you. But someone like Leigh, it was kind of non-sexual. It was very confusing.
Leigh didn't see himself as a drag queen at all, but I did see him in drag once.
What he would call drag and looked like Shelley Winters sort of belonging to perhaps the Gestapo.
I like sort of negative things, like doing the opposite of people, what people expect and what they want. Also, I've got this theory about embarrassment as well.
We'd get on a bus to go shopping in London, and we'd sit down in front of a couple of elderly ladies, and he'd turn around to me and say, do you want to hear about the man I had sex with last night? And I'd say, no. And he'd say, well, he was black, and his dick was this big. And then he would just tell these stories until these women would have to get up and move.
In the early 80s, I remember him talking about embarrassment and saying it was the unexplored emotion, embarrassment. Oh,
Leigh absolutely adored to embarrass people. There's nothing he loved more.
And he was really good at pushing people's buttons, and he knew how to work them, and it was purely for his own entertainment.
But really, a bit for your entertainment as well, because he knew, although you're mortified, he still found it very funny.
And he was one of those people that if you had a weak spot, Leigh would find it. And woe betide.
And you couldn't trust him.
You couldn't
leave your bag or your diary in a room. Any of you, anywhere you went to the bathroom or you had to go out the room,
he'd
go up and pick up the diamond, rummage through, check how much credit cards were in there, who you had a date with and everything, and put it down, and everything was tidy by him to get back.
His idea of a perfect dinner party would be to invite six people who hated each other's guts.
He certainly was manipulative, yeah, he was. But at the same time, somehow wonderfully generous. And
he could be just incredibly, sort of immaculately, perfectly mannered, and he had an incredible sort of courtesy.
He was very, you know, quite tender and actually very,
yeah,
very concerned.
Very sensitive.
About everybody, you know, things and everybody.
Mm. Very giving, very unselfish.
You wouldn't think it, but he
very
was.
Unselfish person.
And that was the beauty of him.
Exactly, that's why we got on so well.
So, big bundle of contradictions.
He was great with my son Jack. We did a christening in Findon Village, and Leigh came down and was the perfect, perfect godfather. He was charming, amusing, caring and loving, and he got on very well with all the grandmothers. Yeah, he told people that maybe he was possibly Jack's father. And I was asked quite a few times whether this was true, whether Leigh was the father of Jack.
Well, you never knew what he lied about, what was truth. That was the whole thing. You never, half the time, you didn't know what was true and what was not.
But then maybe the truth isn't the most exciting place to get to in relation to Leigh.
I think Leigh was probably a little bit more complex than we knew.
He had this incredible ability to get people to open their mouth and expose themselves to him, and that was why he was the dentist.
Leigh used to really pump people for information. He wanted to be the one with the most gossip. And he would take these stories and elaborate on them so that by the time he told someone else, it was complete fiction.
You just end up just like opening yourself up to him, knowing it was a mistake.
It'd be on broadcast news.
Next morning, yeah. Breakfast conversation.
All these snippets of personal information and truth about you were coming back to you from all these different, you know, angles. And you knew where the source of gossip, you know, mouthiness was coming from. Miss Bowery.
Sometimes it would just be, you know, really a joy to be in on a kind of weekday night, and Leigh would phone up and say, you know, put on Channel 2. And we would watch a whole stupid lifestyle program together and just, you know, rip everyone to shreds. You'd be on the phone just going, you know, Leigh'd be going, what is she wearing? Or
sometimes we'd be on the phone, we'd both be watching Brookside, and we wouldn't speak for the whole half hour. We just have the phones resting against their heads. And they just had to go, oh, look at that bit, oh, yeah. Our phone bills were horrendous.
I'd be up in the morning, I'd be up early, I'd be sequining away in the sitting room watching daytime TV. And he'd be chatting on the phone next door, screeching and screaming with laughter, regaling the nights before activities or who said what or who did what to whom. And around maybe 5 o'clock, he'd be getting a bit peckish and think about food, and then maybe we'd get a take-in. And then sort of like maybe about 7 or 8 o'clock, he'd think about maybe cutting out a pattern, sewing it up. And then all night he'd just be sewing or getting other people to sew for him. Or he'd be cutting and chatting, whatever. And I'd still be in the sitting room, sequining away.
Actually, this look was inspired, I thought, that because I tend to use quite a lot of makeup, and I was on an economy drive, and I thought the more fabric that's on the face, the less makeup I use.
It is quite a disturbing look, I think.
Thank you.
The sequined look, we started off with huge, enormous sequins, and then gradually they went down to minute ones. As the sequins got smaller, the garments got bigger.
Now, you're doing a kind of one-man show in a gallery in London.
That's right, it's an art event, and it'll be in the Anthony Doffey Gallery in Dering Street. And what I'll be doing there is actually sitting behind a plate of glass. Well, that's what will appear to the people who come and see me, but actually it's one of those two-way mirror affairs. So all I'll be seeing is my reflection, and so I won't have to deal with the audience at all. And so I think it's just an experiment of me and, you know, what sort of my reflection brings out in me.
He had a very strong look each day, and then he lay on a divan, a 19th century divan, and sometimes he'd sort of stare at himself or kind of fix his dress or then stand up and do poses and things like that. He didn't sing and dance or anything. He just moved around and primped and preened.
It's a bit like going to the zoo and watching Guy the Gorilla in drag or something.
Some people came every day to see the different looks. They got very good reviews, and there was a real buzz about it.
You know, it's not doing a little performance in some sleazy nightclub. It's proper establishment art.
The Doffey show confirmed for many people how important Leigh's work was, in a sense, recognising the fact that he made a contribution in that way. Instead of being some personality on the club scene, people took it seriously. It was the first time that a lot of people had seen Lee during the day, for instance, so that made a big difference.
In the daytime, Leigh was also kind of keen to have a fashion look, and it was always kind of wholesome kind of looking, but in a rather perverted way.
I must say that there are some club people who I see all the time in club, and I can walk past them in the daytime and they won't recognise me.
Seeing him in the daytime for the first time when he came to watch rehearsal was like meeting somebody completely different. His behaviour was completely different. The way he dressed was quite different.
You know, kind of the clothes that someone would wear if they weren't making an effort. But it wasn't that, of course. It was a calculated look. And it was just so disconcerting.
Kind of like a flasher meets
serial killer stroke.
He
file
thought
stroke.
He looked completely normal.
You know,
that was the funny thing.
Child molester.
You'd think his face, his eyes had a slightly different shape, and then you realise that he'd sellotaped the sort of side of his head up.
So he wore these wigs that he was convinced looked real, and they were the most unreal-looking wigs you've ever seen in your life. Like ladies, old ladies, grey curly perms that he'd sort of perch on his head.
Through which you could see all the ribs and sewing.
He thought it was looked so natural. He'd go swimming in it.
Yeah. Oh, the sauna.
Take it out, go to the sauna.
In the wig.
And then he had this really strange thing where he wanted to be tall. Because though he was tall, he seemed taller than he was. He was actually only about just over 6 foot. But he wanted to be more gigantic. So he used to take to wearing a pair of stilettos inside a pair of trainers with really long trousers. So it looked like he was really tall. But really, it was these stilettos that he had balanced inside a pair of trainers. So how could he possibly have done that? I can't imagine. It must have been so uncomfortable, and that's just in the daytime, walking around.
Don't you think that the most ridiculous things are the things that you end up liking the most? The more stupid it can be, the better.
Raw sewage. Started off as the Quality Street Rappers. And then they changed their name to Raw Sewage, which is, well, you know, that's really only ever a row we had. He didn't speak to me for 2 days when I said, Leigh, I don't think you're ever going to be top of the charts with that group. And he was furious that I could say such a thing.
Well, he decided to do Raw Sewage and recruited myself and Sheila Tequila. So the first thing we decided was we had to sing live. There'd be no lip syncing. And then the second thing we decided was it wouldn't be just drag. We'd do it sort of in a more sort of avant-garde way. We decided that rather than doing disco or house or those sort of things, we'd go for a more aggressive stance. So we decided to cover Run DMC and choreographed a whole routine for it, singing live. Altogether, Raw Sewage must have performed between about 12 and 15 times. The video that Raw Sewage cut in the none other than the Trocadero booth, make your own video. Someone had the bright idea we should go incognito to the Trocadero shopping centre in Piccadilly Circus, where they have a make your own pop video booth. So we went down there about 6 o'clock on a Saturday evening with blackface, tartan dresses, the works, and marched straight to the front of the queue, as you do, and instigated singing this song. And the booth technicians were speechless, so much so that we had to do it a second time because they'd forgot to press play and record. They were just standing there like goggle-eyed, mouths open. So we did it a second time and it went okay. The video, well, the results are still around and it only cost £15.
You know, and however much he thought that the country was ready for these three drag queens, half naked, I don't think they really were.
Leigh tried to shock people, and one wonders why it was that he chose to do that.
He wanted to push his own boundaries, I think. That was his first priority, to push his own boundaries. And then if he had an audience to that, all well and good.
We did a show in Amsterdam in Fort Asper in this summer art gallery, and Leigh decided to be suspended upside down while he sang his song, while I played guitar, naked and covered in balloons.
This is like a dream. This is so unreal. I can't believe it is true. It's so beautiful.
He was told it wouldn't hurt him as he went through the smashed glass, but it did. It came down on ribbons on him and cut him badly, and he was screaming, "Shut the curtains, shut the curtains." Afterwards, he realised that he shouldn't have said, "Shut the curtains," he shouldn't have let the blood be a part of the performance.
Human body is the area that I'm interested in, and also its appearance and the way it can be changed.
'90s, Leigh began a collaboration with a photographer named Fergus Greer, where over the course of 4 years they documented more than 40 different looks that Leigh had designed over previous 10 or 12 years. When you look at the contact sheets from these sessions, you get a very clear sense of performance.
Well, simply because I'd be dressed up and it'd be so extreme that there was a performance sort of going on without me even knowing it, and so I thought I'd take charge of that. I think about getting reactions from what I do, and I certainly, with the work I do, it wouldn't be much good if I just kept it all to myself and at home. An audience is a big part of it, and yeah, and communicating and selling ideas is what it's all about. One period where my favourite fabric was flesh, human flesh. I didn't wear any clothes for a while.
Leigh Bowery is a glorious and sort of highly aesthetic example of pure craft, of something that was very, very difficult to make, of originality.
I wanted to wear something that was so either so ridiculous or so large or so impossible that it wouldn't be, the issue wasn't like setting trends. I wanted it to be a bigger issue, not just like, oh, it's going to be in fashion for 3 months.
wasn't just dressing up and showing off and shocking a few people. I think it actually had to have some kind of radical element of change within it. There had to be something that was, contra, against. He'd go, yeah, I saw that show, I saw that exhibition, I saw those paintings, but he said, yeah, but where's the poison?
Leigh Bowery is particularly important now at the start of the 21st century because he represents the cult of pure artifice and pure alienation during a culture which has become obsessed with authenticity.
No, there's never anything practical about Leigh. It was an aestheticization that he wants to, spook people out. He liked to use the word spook a lot. He thought, oh, that'll spook him.
There obviously is pain and pleasure in all of the things that I do, but there's sort of a tension between a really light-hearted side and also a very dark sort of side and something glamorous, but also something really horrifyingly twisted.
On the one hand, what he's doing is raising all kinds of ideas about being some kind of beautified monster in some of his images. In other ways, he becomes a sort of classic clown figure, sort of merging together some kind of, bad dream of Magritte with a pantomime dame.
His figure was incredible, and I mean, he had a lot of aura around him. And the other big thing was his extraordinary relationship with Lucian Freud. The apotheosis was reached with those incredible paintings that Lucian did of Leigh Bowery, and I mean, they are amazing paintings, incredible images of an age, and amongst Lucian Freud's very greatest pictures, without any doubt.
We somehow imagined that it would be a real challenge for Lucian to paint sequins and feathers and makeup, because it seems to us at the time that what Lucian really wanted was then to kind of take away all artifice and show the person as a kind of human animal in a way. And one of the most extraordinary human animals that we could think of was Leigh, because he seems to be sort of diametrically opposed to what we thought Lucian was interested in.
My father told me, he said to me, I'm thinking of painting Leigh, and I thought, God, yeah. And then suddenly one day he'd started and he said that he'd asked Leigh to come over and turn his back, and when he turned round, Leigh was naked, and so he said, oh, you do want me in the nude, don't you? And Lucian said, oh, yeah. And that's how it started.
Leigh was the first person who made a kind of living out of being outrageously himself in some sort of costume. But of course, as soon as Freud took his clothes off, or he took his clothes off for Freud, he became a sort of private person. It's a different kind of performance.
As soon as Leigh started sitting for my father, he kind of told him anecdotes and they exchanged information. They seemed to have a similar kind of very detached way of looking at things and an appreciation of, of extreme things. He brought all these magazines of fist-fucking round to show my dad.
Leigh enjoyed the perversities of Lucian's mind, yet at the same time the undeniable humanity that was there as well.
They had a lot in common. They're both very fastidious people with a kind of anarchic sense of humour. And they hit it off immediately.
I think, although Leigh admired Lucien very much, he didn't treat him with the kind of respect that, shall we say, an art student might have had for the great Freud. And Lucien liked that. Lucien painted several pictures of Leigh, and to begin with, there's Leigh sitting back in a chair, very bulky. Not so much enormous, because he wasn't that enormous, but because Freud was close up to him, he looks like a kind of man mountain. And he's challenging. He's sort of staring the painter down.
One of the nice things about sitting for Lucien is that he's such good company, and that's the main thing. I mean, there's the painting, which is amazing, but then there's being with him, which is just as kind of gratifying and interesting and enjoyable. You know, it's a good education, and I'm sure Leigh immediately made as much use of that as possible.
And then there's Leigh showing off. There's Leigh lying on his back naked, of course, one leg in cocked over the bed, with a kind of teasing, sort of clownish look on his face. And this time it's Leigh showing that he can maintain a very elaborate and exhausting pose for much longer than any ordinary person could possibly do so.
Pictures grow. It's not like a photograph. There's a sort of time within them.
It's actually a very lovely thing to do, is to actually have that time to just think, because you think all sorts of things, and it gives you ideas. I came over to Lucien's flat, where his studio is, and he just said to us to make ourselves comfortable on the bed and to put ourselves in an arrangement. And the one that we ended up doing was the third or fourth kind of different posture. And he liked that one. He said, oh, yeah, that's good. And, you know, so he ended up painting that one.
And then there was Leigh with his back to Freud, in which Freud is more or less a kind of fly crawling across the vast expanses of Leigh from shoulder to buttock.
That texture that Freud gets of flesh tone, and the way that Freud manages to explore whole states of mind to do with corporeality and to do with identity.
It really did seem to mean a great deal to him having that time with Lucien.
What Leigh brought to Lucien's paintings was a kind of superhuman presence. I mean, a physical presence, because he was so physically large, and also a kind of presence in the room because he was sort of larger than life as a person.
His whole persona was a mask. Even the pictures when he sat for Lucien Freud, that was still a mask. I don't suppose they were really, really Leigh himself, even in those paintings.
There's a weird moment in which suddenly there's this absolute parity between a great, down-the-line oil painter and a person whose own cultural practice, for want of a better word, is virtually unclassifiable.
He was absolutely tickled at being turned into a kind of art gallery, art museum masterpiece, rather than just a self-made masterpiece.
He was very good at attending the openings and things that my father didn't go to, because he never does. And Leigh was perfect. You know, he went to New York, and I love the photograph of him being just surrounded by minute people just gazing at him while he was sort of decked out in splendour in the middle of the Met Museum. He seemed a perfect kind of, you know, ambassador, sort of representative. He made it entertaining and really interesting for everybody.
His eyes are closed, and he's very hollow-cheeked and dark under the eyes, unlike in all the rest where he's sort of performing. This is him sort of half asleep and certainly absent. And that's the last painting. And it's got, I think one can now see, a kind of premonition to it. And in some ways it's the best, I think.
There'd been this mountain of rags building in the corner of Lucien's studio, which he used to wipe his palette knives and brushes and things on with oil paint. And Leigh had decided that something should be done with them. He couldn't stand the thought that Lucien was going to get rid of them or throw them away or something. So he'd asked Lucien, and Lucien said he could have them. And out of the blue, he decided he wanted to make a portrait of Hitler using this fabric. So he enlarged this pencil drawing of Hitler shouting using a sort of grid method on the living room floor. And we then sat there cutting all the rags into small squares and allocated each of these squares of fabric to reproduce the picture in Lucien Freud tones. And it took a very, very long time.
Lucien loves the outrageous. He loves the distasteful. He loves things that get up people's noses. And Leigh did all that so wonderfully.
There's hardly anything that I forbid myself to do. And I always want to do more extreme things and be in contact with more extreme people and ideas and practices.
If Nazism was shocking, then he would do Nazism.
Because it was a sensitive subject, it meant that it kind of brought very strong feelings to things.
I think Leigh thought it was a marvellous way to use Lucien's rags, was to turn them back into a piece of Nazi propaganda. He was trying to rub Lucien up the wrong way for some reason, but Lucien loved it. So.
He was always looking to do things that he'd never done before, in a sense. With the band, with Minty, I think he wanted to find another avenue for the distribution of his ideas.
Well, when we started Minty, we had a plan. We'd start as a duo and then expand into a group.
He really thought that now his interest in fashion and art and music could all come together.
And he said to me, look, you know, I've got a reputation and lots of exposure, but I don't have any money. And he was hoping that the band would actually enable him to make some money.
We imagined it, that we could go on to great things like Stadium Rock with great big shows.
Minty!
Hold on. Wait a minute. Let us put some groove in it.
The reason I formed up with Leigh, really, in the first place, is that visually I'd want to go and see a show of Leigh's, whatever it was. With Leigh basically came up with all the ideas and generously gave ideas to me and the other members of the band, what we could wear or do. We were both interested in Fist and the lesbians that went to this club called Fist at the time, because they gave a whole new vibe and it were so tough looking, and we thought we should write a song for the lesbians that went to Fist. And I can't remember what I said to Leigh, but in the end he said, what, you want me to say I'm a worthless, useless man? I said, oh yeah, that's it. And that's the song.
Boot-licking, piss-drinking, finger-fricking, tit-tweaking, laugh-biting, ass-licking, shit-stabbing, motherfucking, spunk-loving, ball-busting, cock-sucking, fist-fucking, lip-smacking, thirst-quenching, cool-living, ever-giving, useless man.
I mean, I think that Useless Man was a brilliant pop record. I mean, it would never have got played on the radio. It was great to see sort of music and performance art being kind of joined together, and he certainly wasn't compromising, you know, visually or in what he was saying.
They always tried to have a transformation. It would change into something. I mean, the biggest transformation was the birth.
Whenever sort of we do something that's consciously subversive, it feels like there's slightly more sort of room, more sort of air to breathe or something like that. It feels like you know, something worth doing. It was Nicola that was the fascinating thing. You could believe Leigh would make Nicola do that, but did that poor woman, what she must have gone through for that show.
being upside down with her facing Lee's crotch the whole time.
It wasn't particularly bad, but it was very claustrophobic.
That is rubbish!
Gentlemen, there, what did you think?
It's quite art that shocked me, and that is the biggest load of pony that I have seen on telly for years.
OK, who was that art?
I only can say to that
hold
that
on, quiet, it... please.
That it was amusing, it was frivolous, it is in the tradition of contemporary vaudeville, but
on,
I must add, I wish I could have given birth at the same amount of time that Leigh Bowery did.
That was quick, wasn't it? Yeah. Why do you do it? Do you go out to shock? Is that a deliberate attempt, shock?
I certainly hope to stimulate people.
Right.
And if they're shocked, that's fine as well.
Who else, what did you think of that? Yeah, did you think that was good?
If he can make something of it, if he can make a living, it's great art. I mean, all credit to the guy.
It seems that everyone's more interested in sort of the amount of money these things are worth than in the quality of them. And I think it's because, you know, the audience seem to be such a dreary, unimaginative crowd that they find making money so completely difficult that artists who have imagination and ideas and who actually stimulate people and then fetch great prices through their work is something that most of these people could never achieve.
I think this man's just a sick pervert, to be honest with you.
Leigh asked me to marry him after we did a very successful Minty show. And it was so good that he was in a very, very good mood in the cab on the way home. And he just sort of like, he said, I've been thinking, Nicola, that I think that we ought to get married. And how do you feel about that? And I said, oh, yeah, that sounds cool. I went, okay, then, you sort it out. That was it. We got married on the 13th of May because he liked the idea of it being Friday the 13th. Leigh said it was like a little art performance between the two of us, and that kind of made sense rather than it being a romantic thing. And as far as I was concerned, regardless of whether we were married or not, I was going to be with him. And I liked the idea that it was a little artistic performance between the two of us. It was pretty camp, the whole thing.
We had booked to do 6 shows at the Freedom Cafe in Soho. Leigh was complaining of feeling a bit fluey. We didn't know he was worse, more ill than that. We toned the shows right down because they were told it's Westminster Council and they didn't want to lose their license for being showing anything sexually explicit or dubious. But after the first show, we were banned anyway by Westminster Council. And that turned out to be our last show.
Many years ago, Leigh had actually told me that he was HIV positive. And I cried all day and cried all night. And then the next day, Leigh told me it was a joke, and so I chose to believe it was a joke, as he was a pretty convincing liar.
And not anyone that knew.
Hearing that Leigh was as ill as he was when I heard was a terrible shock.
And as it was, he only had 5 weeks of sickness, which is a lot less than most people, but if only he'd lasted a bit longer, because they have all this triple therapy or whatever, and I'm sure he would have been all right.
And Leigh died on New Year's Eve, 1994.
And he told us what he wanted done, and there was, like, 3 rules, I think. He wanted his body to go to Australia, no one wants to know his middle name, and he didn't want any mention of God at his funeral service.
I think his background was very strong in his mind. I think hence the reason for him wanting to be buried in Australia.
And on the day that we had Leigh's funeral, we just had it at the gravesite. And so we had just, I think there was only about 8 or so people, just really close friends and family. And I just read some Oscar Wilde poetry because Leigh loved Oscar Wilde. And we drank champagne and smashed the glasses on the coffin. And then we proceeded to put Leigh into the hole, and the hole was not big enough. And so we couldn't actually get him into the ground. And so that we literally had to dig this hole bigger to put Leigh in right there and then. And So he dug the hole and popped him in and threw out champagne bottles and glasses and played some music and came home. And knowing Leigh, obviously, he was watching, judging it. He probably would have said, you know, I wouldn't have done that or I wouldn't have done this. So we had a big feast, and on that day there was this extraordinary storm like I've never seen before. And we had hailstones that were the size of golf balls, you know, sort of seemed to fit with what was going on in the day.
Look at yourself.